Hey guys, Will Clarke here for another deconstruction. Today I'm going to be going through my record Mucaj, which is currently out now on True Soul Records. Today it's going to be another simple record, but this record actually means a lot to me. It's one of my favorite records I've ever made. And I actually wrote this on a train in the UK on the way to a festival. The idea was made on a train, very simple record. For me, this record was just about capturing emotion, and kind of, it's not a club banger, as people would say. It's more of a record that, for me, that it just means a lot to me, and it really like hits me hard and kind of gives me the feels. So hopefully you guys can learn how I make a record like this. Recently, all the deconstructions have all been like hard banger records. This whole EP is more of like an emotional EP for me. Let's just start with what you first hear, which is this pad. Just opening the pad, it's very simple chords. And these run for most of the intro, or up until the track kicks in. And this is like, these chords, let's see what they are. I can't remember off the top of my head. So it's a my music theory is nothing special. My keyboard's not working, people. Come on. Let's see if this... No, it's not plugged in. That's why. Let's plug it in. As you can see, this studio is pretty fresh. It's pretty new. And now it's still not working. Next try. Here we go. So the chords are E, B, and E. So it's E minor. E minor, then it goes, the E stays there, and there, A minor. So it's like a very minor kind of record. It's like pretty depressing when you first hear that, which like gives you some emotion. So let's go into the actual instrument on this, which is part of Monarch. Is it Monarch? No, it's part of Prism on Reactor, Native Instruments Reactor. And honestly, I just went through presets. I love this pad so much. Honestly, I don't really know too much about this synth, and I don't even know if I've done too much automation. The track isn't even on, so there's no automation at all. There's a slight bit of compression, which I believe is going through to the kick, which I don't actually know if it... actually ever used during the kick over here. So you can hear the kick is just side chaining the synth, just so it kind of glues together a little bit more. It's nothing too exciting. Let me hear that with the kick, and then let's look at the compressor. You can see it's like pumping away, just fits it in with the rest of the record. And then let's just, everything's really simple. So let's just move to like the main part, which is the lead, which is actually from a prophet. Which is the 11 brass preset. And I've done quite a lot of kind of processing on this as well. But let's go into the main hook, this baby. Like, as in on a keyboard, on this trusty thing, I just put this in. So how I started this was, I actually started with these chords and then was like, okay, I need to make a melody out of these chords and turned it into this. So I'm using the same notes that the chords that I use in the chords. So you got that, an A, and then you got an octave up, and then you have octave down, and then you have E, and then along these you have these E's just like kind of giving a bit of a groove. So let's play it again. I'm going to play that with the kick. So it looks complicated, but it's all just a groove and parameter, like within the same chords as the emotional A minor and E minor chord that you heard at the original intro. So on the actual record, I'm going to take all of the processing off and then you can hear what it is. So it sounds pretty flat and boring. Tower reverb, world's famous. Just adds a little bit more, kind of like, it just makes it sound bigger. So on the Tower reverb, I've actually, around 410 hertz, I've actually dropped it down. So you're not getting the low end of the reverb, you're just getting that high end. And then channel EQ, this is just kind of pushes it through the mix. So I've taken a few of the low end out. But if you look on the analyzer, we've got a lot of frequencies from like 50 to 100. And then it needed like a boost at around 500 to 1,000 K. You hear it without, that drop down, and then you hear it back up how it was. It just like pops through a little bit more. Echo Boy, I believe you can hear that, like the high cut is not, there's not a high cut at all, but there's a low cut which is max. So all I'm getting is a delay of the like really high end thing. So I'm going to turn everything off apart from the Echo Boy. So this is with the Echo Boy off, dry. So this is with the Echo Boy on. You'll just hear a little like simmer at the top. And that just adds that. So with both of those, the EQ and the Tau on, Decapitator, let's see what's going on here. So the mix is nearly fully wet and the drive is at 2. So the Decapitator actually takes a bit of the low end out, which is always quite interesting. It's just distortion, just like thins it out a little bit more. However, it just adds a little bit more grit to it. So let's hear it, all the plugins off. So you lose that low end a little bit, but it also grittens the high end up, so it like really cuts through the mix, all three of them on. So the isotope, this is an imager which makes things wider and frequencies in certain ranges mono, certain frequency ranges a lot wider. So as you can see, you've got this range here, so from 140 hertz down, and then you got from 2000 hertz down to 140 hertz, so this is this band, and then you got this band, which is the 10k to 2k band 3, and then you got the 20k to 10k. So what I've done here is, you can see on the screen, is that around, you've got the stereo width, and then this little circle here means that it's mono. So everything below 140 I've turned to mono. They're the like frequencies, like the kick and the bass, that you really don't want wide. You want them to kind of be just straight down the middle of the club, so you don't really lose them. Then from 140 to 2000, I've kind of added a little bit of stereo width, but not much. Technically, if I was being a real proper engineer, I would probably turn it to like that. So like everything around from like 300 is mono, but I didn't on this record and it sounds good enough. So above 2000, I've given it a little bit more width. We're going a lot more to the stereo, and then on the high ends, I've put them even higher, which just spreads it out. So if you look at this, you can see on this vector scope is how wide things are actually going. And you can just see like it just pulls it out a little bit. By pulling it out, it just adds a little bit more, kind of gives it that epic feeling, which you don't necessarily, in some of my records, you don't really get. I'm usually just like four to the floor, like big record. This is more of like like I said, I wanted to capture some emotion, and for this, it really did do this. So I got a compressor. Let's see what this baby's doing. So this is being linked to the sidechain. So if you look at the top here, I've got a sidechain. With this sidechain, it's just a kick drum. So it's a kick drum that has no output, which means that it's not being sent to the master channel. All that's doing is just sending an audio kind of signal, which means that I can then sidechain anything to it. So instead of, there's some records that you'll hear that's being sidechained to the kick, and what you'll hear is that when the kick goes, it gets really loud, and then when the kick comes back in, because it's being sidechained to the kick, it's going to be brought down a lot in volume. The reason why I use this sidechain is that it's constant, so there's constantly being sidechained, so there's no like variation in volumes or anything like that. So this is just, so that's with the sidechain, less without. It's like very slight. All this will do is it just keep it off the kick, so the kick still pumps through, so the lead isn't like overpowering. So let's hear it with the kick. Also gives it a little bit of what's the word? Velocities. So the velocities changes a little bit. So the side, when the kick hits, the lead goes a little bit quieter, and then the other lead notes are a little bit stronger. Just adds a little bit of movement. Last but not least on this channel is the creative filter. which is just automated throughout the whole record. It's actually not, it's actually only automated through one section of it, which is here. Just the low pass filter, nothing too exciting. Also, on the automation of this record, I've got a lot going through. So I'm automating the wet for the tower reverb. I'm automating the cutoff filter for the prophet, so this baby. What else am I automating? I'm automating the mix of the Echo Boy. And I'm also automating the feedback of the Echo Boy. So we've got the mix here, and then we've got the feedback. So the feedback is how long the echo comes back at you. So you can re with this with the Echo Boy, you can really make some really creative sounds by adding feedback. It kind of can add a lot more tension to the record. Moving on, let's go with the percussion and the kick. Kick, very simple. Quite a heavy kick. I've compressed it a little bit. Let's hear it without the without the compressor. So you can hear there's a lot more, like a little bit more low end in, without the compressor. The compressor just tightens the kick up a little bit. I've also added a distortion, so it's still like you're not losing the low end. It just tightens it up, but also adds a little bit on the top to like pump through. Clap. So this is a really interesting clap. This is just a white noise clap that I've made through the Tau Uno, which is an emulator of the Juno. I think it's the Juno 106, I believe. All it is just a white noise. So as you can see, I've on the oscillators, I've turned down the sub oscillator, and all you're getting through is the noise oscillator. Pretty simple. It's just a hit, which most claps are, but I just wanted to like create something that's like, it's not like a normal k clap. It's more of a ch clap, if that makes sense. And with that, I've automated the release, and the filter cutoff, but the filter pretty much stays the same apart from in this section. So you'll see the release kind of move up, as you can see. Let me press play, and then this will move up. Back down. I really like doing this. It's really effective when it comes to like making claps. On the record, I've added the decapitator. I'm gonna turn all the processors off, and then you can hear it without. So that's it. It sounds pretty weak. So decapitator, punish mode on, full wet. I've also put the drive to 3, which you can hear adds a lot more. And now on the EQ, I've taken the low end out and just added around 1K. So if you look on the multimeter, you can see where it's pumping. So you're getting like a lot of frequencies all from this one clap, which in a simple record like this, you want a lot of things to kind of fill in gaps. So with a kick and a clap, I'm going to move it over here so you don't get the. Moving on to the hat. Very simple hat. This is just a sample, I believe, or I don't think I have machine. Let me have a look. Let me open machine, see if there's anything in here. Okay, so it's all from here. This hat is that, which is a sample that I've got. Just a hat. Nothing too exciting. Towel reverb. So I do this a lot of my hats where I use it to like create tension a little bit. So you can hear the reverb going up and up and up. Back down to dry. The hat isn't actually that loud in the mix as well. You can't really hear it that much. Shaker. It's literally, I think this is from machine as well. If I remember, yeah. So it's actually a sample pack. I'm pretty sure I did this, which I don't know why it's not saved. But I would have edited that. Yeah, so you can see. This is annoying. So I've actually edited the sample length. So maybe it's that. There you go. So then you go back to the shaker. Not that shaker, the shaker. And you can hear it's just a little bit fainter. I've turned it down a lot. It's not really a huge part of the record. The percussion's very simple in this record. Second shaker, again, it's just different frequencies. So if we look at the multimeter, so that is like all around 4K to 16K. Then the second shaker just fills out that 1K to 4K. And then I've got more shakes, which I don't have. I just love the shakers. It's more of an open hat. So let's go back to the multimeter. And that's just getting mostly around the 8K to 16K. So add those together. And the hat. Clap. As you can see that all of those kind of frequencies are just pushing, they're pretty much making everything level, apart from the kick is like a lot higher, around the 50 hertz. But it just works. Then I've got a big hat, which is pitched down using the wave sound shifter. So I'm going to take all of this off. Just that. Pitch it down. Then I've added the little plate reverb. So low cut, so taking out all the reverb, the low. And then I've got the dry up a little bit. Nothing too exciting in this. It's just very simple reverb, really. And then on this, we have a 909 ride, which I love. No processing on at all. So all this is in the machine, I believe. Let's go back. In fact, I actually think this is the ride. Yeah. It's just a ride, which is, if I go into this, it's that. I use it a lot in my records. I can't remember what sample pack that's from, but I love it. It's amazing. And that is literally all the drums. I also have an EQ kick, which I do in a lot of my records. This is the best thing I ever learned sometimes. I used to put like a EQ on the kick, on the main kick, just like a DJ filter, and then I used to have to automate it. And I don't know why, but OC and Verd boys, they showed me this, and I was like, why do I not do this? So all I've done is copy that kick and then added a high pass filter on. So it cuts the lows, and it's just a low kick. It's really good for like breakdowns and things like that. Very simple. So let's go into the rest of the record. Coming up, I have, obviously you've got the pads coming in. Zoom in. So these are here. So we've got some more pads on here, which is the M1, which is, I think is the, yeah, the, pretty sure it's the Dyna Strings preset. It's a proper like old school house kind of sound. Which I believe, playing the same chords, but it actually sounds really like out of key because these Dyna strings are like a little bit off. But it seems to work over the record. So if you hear it over the record, sometimes a bit of like weird detuning just really does make a record pop. This, I've just boosted, did these EQs up. Pop it a little bit. Just worked really well with that. Moving on to this pad that you're hearing. Which is a great synth from Native Instruments in the Reactor. As you can see, the cutoff is actually being automated up, I believe. Well, it definitely is. Here, what else? And the I've got a creative filter on it as well. So the reactor cutoff filter is going up. Just E, C, which if you go back to the original pads, we have an E and we have a C. So I'm keeping it all in the right key, really, just kind of so everything fits. And as this record, these come in the breakdown. You've heard everything up until now of the record, and this is where I just want to go into the breakdowns of like how I created the like epicness of the record, really, and how I like really built tension. And this is purely just using the Tau Reverb Wet and Dry, the Echo Boy Mix, and the Echo Boy Filter. or feedback, sorry. So as you can see, which is just bringing like all of those high ends really like in your face. And then it comes back down when the record's about to kick back in. Also with that, this pad here is the filters coming up. So as this goes, as the main lead kind of epicness goes down, you've got another pad that's coming up. So hearing it together. Drop it back into the record. What you're going to hear coming in then is you've got this M1, which is here. I've actually added this, so on the lead I've added a few more notes to come in that you'll be able to hear, which is different from the original, from the first drop. So if you hear this, I've added a couple of extra notes, just like a few double notes here and there, a few more like ups and downs. It just adds a little bit more like kind of rhythm, and it also keeps the ears, I call it ear candy, like keeps you excited so you're not hearing the same thing when it drops back in. But also I've added this. Which is just another string, nothing too exciting, but it just adds a little bit more something else that you're like, oh shit, I've not heard that before. And then what comes over here is another one. I'm going to play them all together. But what I've done with this is I'm not playing the same, like all of the same notes. I'm not playing the variation of the new lead. What I'm playing is the original lead. So you're getting extra notes from the lead here. And then you're getting the extra notes from the other strings, and then an octave higher, you're just getting the original notes from the lead record. So it just adds a little bit of variation. So I'm not just adding more and more of the same kind of melody, or you're getting a slight variation of the melody. So it kind of throws your ears off. So it just, again, it just like keeps building you, so you're not hearing the same thing. Play that with all the records on. Completely changes to one note. It just goes a bit mental.
Okay.
again, it's like a very simple record, but using a few very strong elements kind of creates this like real moody, emotional record. Yeah, that is my record, Mucaj, which is out now. If you've got any questions, put them in the comments. More than happy to kind of answer anything, really. If you haven't checked the record out, go check the record out. Link is below. Yeah, thank you very much for listening. I hope this helps. And I'll see you next time on another Deconstruction.